Welcome to the Scripted channel. Here we try to make sense of AI. As you know, we are building a survival guide for coders and tech people. And this is this video that you're watching is a third part of that survival guide. In the previous parts, we were looking at the machine and how it has evolved from the shovel to internet, and why we coders, just a mere providers of labor, why we were paid so much for building that machine. Today, at a part three, we will see what happens when the machine that we have just built, when that machine gets to the next level, when it learns to learn. And for that, we will use our friends data scientists. Data scientists, they will be our guinea pigs, our laboratory rats, if you wish. Because guess what was the first thing that machine did when it learned to learn? Yeah, that's right. It destroyed its own creators. It destroyed data scientists. Well, at least 90% of them. So here's where you're probably shaking your hand. It's like, hey, what this guy is even talking about? Data science, a dead profession? What a nonsense is that? Isn't the data science one of the most in-demand professions right now? Well, true. For example, we just recently learned from a leak from one of the companies that we all know very well. We learned that their AI researchers receive up to $10 million in annual compensation. So it is clear that data science is not a redundant profession. It is a very alive profession. But there is one little thing, one little nuance we need to know. A very interesting thing happens if we take a closer look at the data science teams of almost every big tech firms. Here, for example, this is OpenAI, which is now a part of Microsoft. So that's a very famous scene where NVIDIA's Jason Huang hands over his first Hopper chip. I think it was a Hopper chip. So that's a chip that OpenAI will use to train ChatGPT. Do you see anything peculiar, anything unusual? Yes, that's right. Almost all of them, they're teenagers. And here comes the next logical question.
I don't know about this new crew of yours. They seem a bit skittish. Probably shouldn't tell them what happened in the last crew.
Yeah, right. So, what exactly happened to the previous crew? And the same thing you can see in data science teams across most of the big tech firms. So you don't have to be a mega mind to see that there is something fishy going on here. Indeed, where's the old crew? Once we understand what AI have done to data scientists 10 years ago, we will get a better view on what AI is doing to coders and tech people now in 2024. Our objective is to learn as much as we can from what happened to data scientists so we don't repeat the same mistakes and we don't find ourselves in this situation. By the way, this image was taken just a few days ago in Sydney subway train. So that's very much how the new era, new AI era looks like. And again, I'm probably jumping a gun here, but I have to say that the things are not hopeless. Because as we will see, some data scientists have survived, and not just survived, they actually thrived. And we will try to understand what was their strategy and how they did it. So today we will need three new concepts. They will help us understand what is going on. So the first concept is AI Claw. We will see how it works and how the data scientists, how they operate it. The second new concept is AI Black Box. It is the same black box that Jensen Huang, NVIDIA's Jensen Huang, is referring to when he speaks about coding being a non-human profession. So that's basically the new way of writing software.
And so we imagine that this is a completely new way of writing software.
And after we understand what happened to the old crew, we will analyze the survivors. And this hopefully will give us some hints of how they managed to survive. So the 10% survival rule concept. And hopefully this we will be able to extrapolate that to what is currently happening to the coders and techs, now, 10 years later. And just before we start, for those of us who are here for the first time and are currently wondering, like, hey, who's this new talking head on my screen? I will have to introduce myself. I'm a behavioral economist and AI expert, and I specialize in building AIs and building and designing AI systems that manage human behavior, especially in large groups. After graduating from Columbia University in New York, I've been designing and building AI systems that manage human behavior. I'm also a science fiction writer and a former Forbes columnist covering China. All right, let's start. This is Michael Dell. Yes, the same Michael Dell who has founded a famous Dell company, a computer manufacturer. When Michael was a kid, he needed the money for some reason. I don't know why, don't ask me. And so he started working. Michael started selling Houston Post subscription. Houston Post was a local newspaper in Texas. Now it is a long time since extinct. So his job was to call potential customers and try to persuade them to buy a subscription, a newspaper subscription. And for each subscription sold, Michael was receiving a commission. So Michael just started working and jumped on the phone. As you can probably guess, this was not a very cheerful work, just to cold call people and try to sell them stuff. I can confirm it myself. When I launched my third startup, in the beginning, I had to spend a very considerable amount of time cold calling people and selling ourselves. Was not fun. But unlike me, Michael was an intelligent fellow. So very soon he realized that there is a very interesting pattern. There is a group of people, of customers, who are much easier to persuade. They are much more willing to buy a newspaper subscription. And these customers, these people, they had two characteristics in common. Let's call them like features. So the first feature is that they were recently married. And the second feature was they have moved houses. So it's newlyweds who moved houses. So Michael went to the courthouses around Houston and collected wedding records. And in just 1 week, he has made more money than average American was making in a year. Just imagine that, a kid making more in 1 week, more than an American makes in a year. Not too shabby. So what would a usual salesperson do? Salespeople, they were cold calling people one by one. Just imagine, it is as if there is a huge crowd and you have to call people one by one. It is very similar to our example from previous parts, example with a gold mine and all these diggers who are digging through the huge pile of dirt looking for gold nuggets. So that's pretty much what people usually do. But now Michael comes in, scans this entire pile, somehow sees those nuggets where those nuggets are and picks them up without even digging, and leaving all those poor diggers behind. So that's pretty much what happened. And it is as if Michael has some sort of a secret weapon, like a magic claw. And that claw, it has a name. And the name is intelligence. Natural intelligence. Since the invention of first computers in the 1940s, we humans, we were trying to harness intelligence. It was as if we were trying to make some sort of a computer equivalent of Michael Dell. So the scientists were trying to replicate the brain, that network of interconnected neurons capable of learning and reasoning. Well, indeed, through the billions of years, evolution and nature has created this this mechanism. So why do we, like, called brain, right? So why do we want to reinvent the wheel again if we can just replicate what we already have, replicate the brain? So you just like copy-paste. Back then, scientists didn't really know how the brain works. Well, technically, just between us, they still don't. What they didn't know was that brain is some sort of network of neurons that are interconnected. They're connected to each other and send each other electric signals. And that's pretty much the structure that scientists wanted to replicate, wanted to build. And for some reason that we also don't know very well, they gave this approach a name, a term, deep learning. Again, don't ask me how this name appeared, why they gave this name to this approach. Maybe because neurons, like layers and layers of neurons, they were going deep. Maybe this is why. Again, we do not know anymore. Nevertheless, let's remember this name, deep learning, because we're going to hear it a lot. All right, so we are back into the second half of the last century, the cradle of intelligence. Back then, there was no lack of scientists trying to replicate human brain by using this approach, the deep learning approach. For example, some of them were even able to create a system that was able to recognize handwritten zip codes. And that is in 1980s. Imagine that. So again, there were many scientists trying to replicate human brain. However, all of them eventually faced the same problem. Because we have so many interconnected layers of neurons in deep learning, that means that we have a mind-blowing number of connections, and each one of them has to be recalculated pretty much all the time. And we're talking about millions times a second. So it was not a problem if you have, say, 100 neurons or even 1,000. But what is 1,000 neurons? That's pretty much as many neurons as a nematode has. A nematode is not the most intelligent creature. Basically, all it has to do is just to crawl in the soil, and that's pretty much. You don't have to be a genius to do that, to succeed in that. So, if you want to do a meaningful task, say recognize a fairly complex image, you need to have at least, say, a million neurons. Building a neural network, a deep learning model, is extremely intense in terms of supercomputer time. So you need lots of supercomputer calculations. And supercomputers are not cheap, which is why you need lots of funds to train a model like this. But have you ever tried to approach an investor and ask for money, for funds, for a project that looks like a toy and is not really clear what its chances of success? And what is even less clear is what's a pathway to commercialization. In other words, how are you going to make money on it? This is why by the mid-2000s, all the projects in replicating brain, human brain, they were abandoned. And there were just a few teams left, like fanatical mavericks, like this team, for example. Just a few teams left who were still doing research and experimentation in this field. Naive deep learning dreamers, I call them. So where did this data scientist go then, you may ask? I'm going to tell you. After it became clear that replicating of human brains is not really profitable, you cannot really make your living on this, data scientists moved to other types of models, starting from old-style regression models and decision trees, ending with mind-boggling stochastic equation models. So they were trying to imitate the Michael Dell's claw, but because they could not imitate or replicate the brain, as we have seen, just computers were too slow, right? Instead, they were trying to learn how to operate this claw manually. It is almost as if what these guys are doing when they play with this machine, with the claw, manually. And to do that, there were truckloads and truckloads of PhD research in this field, like endless and endless equations, starting from regression analysis, like primitive regressions, to stochastic equations, and hundreds and hundreds different, extremely complex and loaded with formulas and just the walls and walls of formulas. And all of that research was done for a simple reason. It's basically, you can think of it as if it is some sort of a shortcut. that allows you to operate this claw manually. It's a shortcut. And very soon, this area of research, it has become the mainstream of the data science. Here's where I have to plead guilty, because I've been involved in a few projects like this as well, where we were building this manual claw. Banks or insurance companies, they wanted to have this clause picking fraudsters or defaulters, potential defaulters or some security breaches. And for that, they were ready to pay absolutely mind-blowing amount of money. Just to give an idea, one of the projects that I've been involved, a bank paid $5 million for a small team that built a random forest model for them. Just one simple random forest. So it's like maybe a half a year project. So what it tells us is two things. First one is it was just simply stupid for anybody, any data scientist, to do anything else rather than that, because this is where the money was. And second, what it tells us is this entire field of this manual claw operating, it required lots and lots of manual operators, people who were building, maintaining, and running this claws. So the typical work of a data scientist consists of three major tasks. The first task is data cleaning. So the data we're dealing with is always has lots of inconsistencies, typos, missing data, and it has to be cleaned. So this is type of a task that all data scientists universally hate. This is like the worst thing you can do. However, it usually takes about two-thirds of time, or even more, of data scientists to actually do this dirty part. So the second task is, we're going to call it a feature engineering. And that's pretty much what Michael Dell did when he figured out, when he got that insight that it's actually newly married people who moved houses, that they have that higher probability of purchasing the subscription. So that's feature engineering. That's something that requires lots of industry knowledge and also human judgment. It's based on human judgment. Just as a side note, this is usually what I do. As a behavioral economist, this is where my contribution is into the data science. And then the third task is the most complex task. It's a selection and configuration of the model. And there were hundreds and hundreds of models, truckloads and truckloads of PhD research in this field. And it was important to select the right model and configure it properly so you can get the proper results out of it. So that was a top of the data science profession. So how many people were out there in data science doing these three tasks? Well, a short answer is a lot. It's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of data scientists who were gainfully employed in manual operation of this claw. And they were doing it very profitably until... Yes, until this happened. First contact. All right, please stop there for a second. This is a like collection boost. So the price is one like per coder, or if it happened that you are not a coder, that's all right. We're gonna accept it, nobody's perfect. So the price is one like and a comment. All right, part four is coming soon. You know what you need to do so you don't miss it. See you on the other side.